It was a fictional fan-favorite establishment that was featured on a highly successful 1990s primetime TV show. That show, Beverly Hills 90210, and that establishment, the Peach Pit. The Peach Pit would eventually become just as well known as any given character within the show, and by the time the 90210 series concluded in 2000, the Peach Pit and its memorable storylines would have its place within the 90210 fandom world. So join me as we get ready to adventure into the famous zip code that defined the 1990s. It's all here on this episode of Bri Adventures, Beverly Hills 90210, Looking Back 30 Years, Peach Pit Stories. Armand, and like you, I enjoy a good adventure. Fun, fantastic, and magical journeys await. So sit back as I take a new excursion forward on this episode of Bri Adventures. The city has many stories. LA, Hollywood, Beverly Hills. From the golden age to modern days, the stories told here are endless. Some may feel like a fish out of water here. Others fit right in. If you're looking for some vintage charm, you just have to know where to look. And the stories from yesteryear, well, they're a dime a dozen. However, there is a couple of stories I'd like to share with you today. Stories that blur the lines of vintage Hollywood and modern-day happenings. Sit back and relax. These are Peach Pit Stories.
Recommended.
Love your do, Laverne.
I thank you, Blondie. You know, if you play your cards right, just might let you borrow my coolest.
Oh,
Hey everyone, welcome to Bri Adventures. I'm your adventure guide, Brian Armand, and today we're going to be telling some Peach Pit stories. This show today is all about the Peach Pit and the stories that are told within it, and you're going to be hearing and watching clips from the show.
How many of these things is he gonna do?
Shh. Take it away, Dad.
Before we introduce our guest today for Peach Pit Stories, I'm going to go off track a little bit here. The other day I found something pretty interesting in the 90210 logo. Take a look at the numbers 90210. Now, let's take them away. Let's add back the 90. What do you get? 1990. 1990, the year 90210 first premiered on TV. Some of you might already know where I'm going with this. Now let's look at the next set of numbers, the 2 and the 1 in 90210. If you add them together, you get 3. Now, add that 3 to the last 0 in 90210, and you get 30, which stands for the 30th year anniversary this year. So what you have there is 90-30. That's 1990 and 30 for the 30-year anniversary. It's there. Written within the logo. I want to welcome back our special guest, Jeff, who we had on our last Looking Back 30 Years fan rewind show. Feel free to check that out if you haven't yet. Jeff, thank you again for coming back.
No problem. Happy to do it.
Peach Pit Stories is the second installment in this Beverly Hills 90210 30-year anniversary series. October 4th this year will mark the show's 30th year anniversary. It's hard to believe that the show premiered back in 1990 and is still going strong with fans all over the world till this day. I just think that's kind of like a testament to, you know, what the show was about, and a lot of it still holds up. And I think we talked to you on the Fan Rewind about how really centered and focused on teens and what they were going through during those times in the 90s.
And all those issues that kids in high school were going through at the time, and they hit them all and weren't afraid to go after it. And this way people could see that everyone's going through the same problems and maybe help some people along that were going through them.
Yeah, definitely. And I think that the Peach Pit basically was this central location that the cast could go to and just kind of meet up in one place, and any of these issues that were going on at any given time in the episode, they were able to go sit down, maybe have a mega burger, some fries and a shake or whatever, and it allowed us to kind of get like, okay, this is what they're going through. It's not in that chaotic world. They're sitting somewhere where it's like very calm and relaxed. The 1950s music is playing in the back. Nat is like the father figure to them. They go to him for advice. You know, you always see that. Since Brandon worked there, it was easy for him to be like, hey, Nat, what do you think about this and that? And he was kind of like that father figure to a lot of the cast.
Oh, definitely. He was a safe person to talk to, who actually wasn't your parent, but your Nat was. He was the same age as their parents. I felt safe talking to them because they weren't actually his parent, where they could get into trouble if they mentioned something or worry about. They could speak freely and get actual advice from someone, you know, that's already grown up, has experience, and has a good head on his shoulders. And Matt was a stand-up guy who owned a business and always tried to do the right thing. So, yeah, they felt safe talking to him.
So, Ned, is it always just empty on prom night or what?
It'll pick up later. The revelers will roll in.
God, it's even more depressing than I thought it would be.
Oh, cheer up, pal. For whatever it's worth, I didn't go to my senior prom either.
You didn't?
Nope. I was supposed to take Gina Delmonico. The most gorgeous girl of Fairfax High. But she got the flu. So I ended up behind the counter, just like you.
Well, at least you had a date.
Peach pit. Oh, yeah, honey, hang on. Brando, it's for you. It's Andrea.
Andrea?
Yeah.
Hey.
All right.
Hey, what's up?
Hey, Brandon. I just wanted to tell you how flattered I was that you invited me to the prom. Even though Jordan asked me, and I wanted to go with him, I couldn't think of anyone I would have rather gone with than you.
Andrea, did you call me up here just to tell me that?
No.
Hey, you okay?
Jordan just called. He's in bed with the flu. I'm sitting here all dressed up with no place to go.
Don't you move. I'll be there in 20 minutes. Matt, old buddy, old pal of mine, I hate to do this to you, but I am out of here. I'm going to my senior prom. What happened? Andrea's date just pulled a Gina Delmonico.
Adding to that, I would just like to say that Nat walked Donna down the aisle in the series finale when she got married to David.
After Donna's father passed away from the heart attack.
Correct. So, I mean, he was definitely, like you say, like a real stand-up guy. And because he was around the age of their parents in the show, I mean, it was just somebody outside of the family that you could talk to that's, you know, not your peer. It's not like going like Brandon talking to Dylan. He's definitely going to get different advice for someone his own age versus...
Kids your own age, they haven't gone through stuff that adults have gone through.
Right.
So yeah, you could definitely get different advice.
And they knew Nat was not going to steer him wrong because he called them the kids. You know, he knew that was probably like, you know, his family too. He came to
they
work.
They were, absolutely.
Yeah, he enjoyed seeing them come in. I mean, he enjoyed that. That was probably like something he loved. He could have probably sat there forever and talked to them, but we always see Nat as the guy who, hey guys, how you doing? Whatever. And then he goes back to work. He was just like a workaholic at the same time. So he had good work ethics.
Especially in the later seasons when the Walshes were supposedly in Hong Kong. So they didn't have the parents like they did in the first couple seasons. The Walshes were gone and the kids, they needed a, you know, sounding board, a person that had their head on their shoulders to actually give them good parental advice.
And I think that the Peach Pit also played that central location type of venue that I was talking about. A lot of shows that we used to watch and still to this day, new shows that are on, they all have this one central location.
A hangout.
Right, exactly. Seinfeld had Monk's, Friends had the Central Perk, Saved by the Bell had the Max, and Cheers had a bar where everybody knows your name. So yeah, definitely, like you said, a hangout where not only for them, but I think it was also when writers and when they think about these places, I think they have that in mind that we need a place where the cast is going to directly talk to us, the fans, about what they're going through. And it's a great, like you say, a hangout. I mean, we all had that too. We would go to a certain place and you kind of catch up and everything. And you could do that over the phone, you could do that anywhere, but it's a little bit different dynamic when you're somewhere. And then
you're out in the community, seeing faces and people our own age hanging out, doing the same thing.
It was the hangout. It's a nice place to just unwind, relax. If we remember correctly, Dylan was the one who introduced Brandon to the Peach Pit, and that happened in Season 1, Episode 3, Every Dream Has Its Price Tag. Brandon takes a job at this, I think it's like an upscale restaurant, and he finds along the way that the help is getting paid less than minimum wage.
And Dylan came to visit him, and that's when he quit.
Right.
He threw down his apron and said, I'm out of here.
And Dylan, I remember, is like, I'm going to buy you dinner, and something like, I know the perfect place. The next scene is, it's a close-up shot of, the actual peach pie. And then we see they expand out to a wider shot. And then you see Nat. By the way, that peach pit, as we talk about, is one of the three exterior facades. That was the Apple Pan, the original Apple Pan. That wasn't featured in a lot of the other shows going forward. They did another smaller peach pit somewhere else, and then they went to the one that we know about when we were doing the peach pit pop quiz last time on the Fan Rewind. Remember, we were talking about that facade. That was the mainstay. That was the facade that stayed throughout the 10 seasons almost. But the first couple of episodes, they were still trying to find their way with everything. The actual peach pit interiors had a somewhat similar look to what the Apple Pan looked like inside, seeing it's a very famous establishment in LA. The Peach Pit had a very unique, a nice 1950s style. The walls were decorated really nice. You saw the records on the wall. Really nice design inside. And I show a couple of those things on the Fan Rewind, and we'll show a couple of those here, how we could see the Peach Pit, how it looked on the soundstage over at Calvert Studios in Van Nuys versus the Apple Pan, the actual real restaurant.
Right.
What I also liked about with the Peach Pit was Dylan was a surfer. He himself did not like to be referred to James Dean. He doesn't really want to be acknowledged as that for whatever reason, but he was that type of guy. I mean, we think about the 50s and 60s surfer type of atmosphere. He was a surfer. He was kind of like the bad boy rebel. So there is a lot of references, and he had the, I think it's a Porsche 356, but it was definitely a speedster. So a lot of throwbacks in the Dylan character. And also when he comes back from surfing, or he's coming back from school before he goes home, he probably stops by the Peach Pit, and the Peach Pit tie-in, 1950s music playing. So there's a lot of that 50s aura surrounding his character Dylan, that Luke's character Dylan was that 50s type of feel. Do you have any favorite episode that was, I love the Peach Pit in this episode. Any one episode?
There's so many. There's a little clip that they played in the beginning of the montage, the beginning of several seasons, is when Donna's pushing the button on the jukebox, and she's like, Jeremy Jordan or whatever, and he was like a hot singer at the time, and his song comes on. The episode was, what was the name of that group that came on? The three guys, what the heck was their names?
Not Color Me Bad.
Color Me Bad, yeah.
Yeah, that Color Me Bad episode was one of my favorites, and I know a lot of people love that episode. The episode was called Things to Do on a Rainy Day, and it was from 1992. And if you remember back in the Fan Rewind that we did, the first installment of this, that was the episode that we were talking about how when I met Jamie Walters and I felt like I was in that episode, because Kelly goes and meets Brian from Color Me Bad, the lead singer, up at the hotel. And then later on, because Donna and David, it was David's idea to get the gang up there. And the whole thing with Donna's mother having the affair, so she left and she was upset. So they never got to meet the group at the hotel. So Kelly thought it would be nice to probably ask Color Me Bad, hey, could you come down to this local establishment, you know, the Peach Pit, and maybe you could just say hi to my friends? And they decide to just sing right there a cappella.
Hey, that was awesome.
That was right at the end of the episode that they did that too. So I think it was a surprise for the fans. It was a real nice closure.
Yeah, that was a memorable episode.
Yeah, so this is season 2, episode 26, Things to Do on a Rainy Day. So let's go ahead and take a look at a clip from that episode. Well, the next clip really doesn't need an introduction for most fans. It's a memorable scene. It's from Season 1, Episode 16, Fame is Where You Find It. So let's briefly transport ourselves back in time and take a look at a clip from that episode. This is that famous episode, fan favorite, that Brenda fills in for Brandon at the Peach Pit. Brandon got a job. Remember, it was a soap opera, a daytime soap opera. He was in the park, the opening scene, and so he needed someone to fill in. And of course, Brenda, putting on the showmanship, she goes in and she pretends she's Laverne, just a character from like the 50s, and they start singing the Leslie Gore song, It's My Party.
Yeah, It's My Party, yep. Got dressed up as a 50s diner waitress. She was Laverne. She had a New York accent, and she loved theatrics and drama, and she was in a theater group in school, and it just came natural to her. It's become this persona, which now she wasn't nervous and making mistakes with all the customers coming in and busy. And Donna and Kelly got in on singing it too, and the place was packed, and people were waiting, and I think Brandon, she was like worried that Brenda wasn't doing a good job, but they were all just entertained by her.
Yeah. Oh, there was nothing to worry about with Brenda at the helm there, because in those glasses, I have to say, I love that. That really made her costume, like, just that, just buttoned up everything with the glasses, the whole 50s style to it. And like you said, the accent and everything just really played into that episode, and such a memorable episode to this day. I mean, that's like a fan favorite. I mean, when you talk about that episode, it's like almost, you almost would want to see her in that role more. But I think because you ever see something that was just done once and it's so great and memorable that it's not played out, it's not oversaturated, so it actually plays better over time. If she was to be that person for more episodes, it would have been more of a
special.
Right. Remember the episode Home Again, which was season 1 episode 22. Brandon's father, Jim, gets offered a job back in Minnesota for double the salary. He wasn't going to go originally, but then they doubled his salary, so he said, "This is a no-brainer, I have to go." Everybody wants Brandon to stay, this and that. And so as a going away gift, let's just say Andrea and Brandon want to get together.
"I want goodbye to be a moment we both remember."
And remember,
they're on a carousel.
They're on the carousel. At some point, they end up back at the Peach Pit. The shot of them is outside the Peach Pit, and Brandon thinks he's going in there. It's all dark, and he thinks he's going in there to have a going away present. But as soon as they open the door, surprise, and everybody knew that
they had
a big party for him, and they were staying. Season 1, Episode 6, entitled Higher Education. Here we see in this episode, Steve coming into the Peach Pit, trying to convince Brandon to cheat on a term paper and basically just copy it. And so with that, here is that interaction. Let's take a look.
"Steve, man, I can't believe the way that jerk Danzel treated you in class. Everybody was talking.
Yeah, it was real special.
Who does he think he is? He treated me like that.
Steve, what are you doing here?
I don't know. Well, you were talking in the hall today. I got worried you might bust me.
Hey, come on, Steve. I wouldn't do that.
Yeah, I know. It's just, I want you to be in on this one.
It's just not right.
Compared to what? Failing a class, boy? Everybody cheats. Everybody bends the rules. You either take advantage of it or you get left behind.
Brandon, excuse me. I'm curious. You still work here?
Yeah. Steve, I got a chance.
Brandon, what you're probably going to say if you come home with a C or an F?
It's time for another Peach Pit pop quiz. If you watched our last video, Fan Rewind, we started doing these pop quizzes, and they're based on the Peach Pit, which is fitting seeing its Peach Pit stories. Today's trivia is, what are the ingredients used to make a mega burger? And we know the mega burger is the signature hamburger at the Peach Pit.
That would be, of course, cheese, lettuce, tomato, grilled onion, and bacon.
Correct. Yep. Also, and I think it's who you talk to. I've actually seen this online as well. People make their own mega burgers now, so there's so many different ingredients that are out there. People add more things, take things out. Speaking of adding things, though, we're going to go to a clip where Brandon here, this is from the episode The Pit and the Pendulum, season 2, episode 24, Brandon is making the mega burger for a girl by the name of Marcy, and I'll get to that in just a second. And this is what he says should go on it. And there's a little twist with Swiss. Let's check that out. So we see in that scene the girl, Marcy, that Brandon is making the mega burger for, she's actually the daughter of one of Jim's clients. One of Jim's clients wants to actually knock down the Peach Pit in favor for a shopping mall. And everybody kind of rallies around Brandon to help stop that. I believe it's even Nat who wants to sell the place. And I believe Brenda supports Jim, her father.
Right.
You know, and as we saw from this episode, The Pit and the Pendulum, a lot of the storyline of this particular episode was center focused on the Peach Pit. It was the Peach Pit who was really the main star. It was the Peach Pit that was going to be knocked down in favor for a mall. So sometimes we see storylines that are just centered around the Peach Pit, and this is a real good example of that.
Right.
Season 2, Episode 1, Beach Blanket Brandon. School's out for summer. First episode, second season. It probably goes without saying that this is the season that really set off 90210 into the big leagues and really got their ratings up, and they were really great in the summer. And incidentally, this is also the episode, on a side note, that the big Dylan and Brenda breakup scene happens to REM's Losing My Religion. However, since we're talking about Peach Pit stories here, this is where Brandon goes into the Peach Pit and talks to Nat and tells him he has this really big job at the Beverly Hills Beach Club, and he's going to have to leave without giving him notice. And Dylan was trying to tell Brandon as well that he really needs to let Nat know, and so he just kind of leaves him high and dry. Let's take a look.
You see, I got this other job. It's a really great job at the Beverly Hills Beach Club. I'm going to be a cabana boy there, you know, setting up beach chairs and serving drinks, helping ladies with their suntan oil.
Brandon, that sounds great. I guess this dump can't compare, huh?
No, it doesn't have anything to do with that. This other job pays more, and I need the money. I gotta have a car this fall.
Brandon, I've never been a person to stand in the way of another guy's success.
Thanks, Nat. I'm glad you feel that way. I was kind of worried.
when's this new job start?
Tomorrow.
Brandon, I said we were slow, but we're not dead. I can't run this place by myself.
I know, Nat. You'll find somebody. I'll help you.
But by tomorrow? Do you have any idea how many yutzes there are out there? Brandon, it's gonna take me a couple of weeks to find somebody, and then I gotta train them.
Nat, I'm sorry.
One day's notice. Gee, divorce me, but don't desert me, kid.
I don't know what to say.
Say you'll stay until I find a replacement.
Nat, I can't. I told him that I'd...
Okay, I understand. Hey, kid, it's been a lot of fun working with you. And you have yourself a good summer, huh?
Season 2, Episode 6, Pass Not Pass. Now this is a great continuation from the last clip we saw, which was Season 2, Episode 1, entitled Beach Blanket Brandon, where Brandon leaves Nat high and dry without any notice and just gets up and quits to go work at the Beverly Hills Beach Club. Now, in this Season 6 episode, Pass Not Pass, Brandon finds his way back into the Peach Pit. And we see when he comes in here, right, even before he comes, there's the establishing shot outside, and the Peach Pit has all these construction walls up. He comes in, he's looking a little bit confused, he sees that there's a lot of construction going on, they're expanding out to make more seating. This is the episode where he asks Nat to get his job back. Let's take a look.
Excuse me.
So, what can I get you today?
How about 2 eggs, over easy, rye toast?
Please. Anything to drink?
Just water.
Ice?
Sure.
Crushed or cubes?
Whatever.
Hey, Brandon.
Nat.
It's been a long time.
Yeah.
How's it going?
It could be better.
Could always be better.
Yeah, I guess it could. Place looks great.
Yeah, it will if they ever finish it.
So how's business?
It's booming.
Good. So how's the new girl working out?
Here you go, eggs over easy with rye toast.
Need I say more?
I think she's pretty much on top of it.
Yeah, Courtney's a straight-A student from Beverly Hills High. I really lucked out finding her on such short notice. Hey, Brendan. I've seen you more this week than I have all summer. So what can I get you? Your usual?
You remember my usual? I'm flattered.
Don't be. Who could forget a char burger with bacon, fried eggs, with onions, and relish?
Hold the mail.
Don't insult me. Hey, isn't today the big day for the luau at the Beverly Hills Beach Club? Shouldn't you be slicing pineapples or something?
Yeah, it's my last day there. I just came by to see what was going on, you know, see how you're doing.
Nothing much changes around here.
The new girl, she got the job pretty wired, huh?
Courtney? Yeah, I couldn't ask for any more.
She better than I was?
Not better. Different.
Listen, Nat, this is gonna sound kind of lame, but, you think there's any way I could get my old job back?
Gee, I don't know, Brandon. Courtney's really terrific when it comes to punctuality and...
Hey, I was always on time.
Job commitment. She wouldn't race out of here without notice if another career opportunity headed her way.
Nat, I'm sorry, but I explained that to you already. I had to go earn big tips this summer. I had to buy a car.
So where's the car?
It's a long story.
Well, since Courtney's going away to college next week, I guess I'm going to need to hire someone.
How long have you known about this?
A while, but I guess I can give you a trial run.
Uh-huh. And you left me hanging all that time?
Yeah. Welcome home, Brandon.
Season 2, Episode 15, entitled Euphoria, which is another classic episode. Emily takes the group to a rave, an underground rave. This is also the classic episode where the phrase, "I like to exchange an egg," comes from. So basically in the clip we're gonna see, Brenda and Brandon get to the peach pit and we see the group off in the corner. And we see Brenda asking Brandon if he's still okay and wants to go through with going to the club, and he says he's fine. We know how the episode turns out and whatnot, but here's a clip from the peach pit.
Thank you.
Season 2, Episode 23, Cardio Funk. Now, this is a fun episode, especially when it comes to the Peach Pit stories. Trying to get more money into the Peach Pit, trying different things. Nat and the group tries their hand at karaoke, or should I say, they try their voices at karaoke. And who doesn't like a good old karaoke session? It's just a great time all around. Succeed or fail at singing, who cares, it's karaoke. That being said, this clip doesn't need any further introduction. Let's take a look.
I'm gonna do one of my old favorites.
How many of these things is he gonna do?
Shh. Take it away, Nat. There she was, just a walking down the street, singing do I did.
I do not know that man.
Come on, Mrs. Walsh, she's great.
So, what
do you think?
He looked good.
She looked fine.
Look fine, does she looks good on a blue man.
Season 3, Episode 1, Misery Loves Company. Now, this is a great episode. You could never go wrong with a Steve-centric episode. They're just great. And Steve, in this episode, definitely delivers. Steve starts working at the Peach Pit to prove to Brandon that he could hold down a job, and Brandon basically goes along with the bet. And since this is the first episode of Season 3, Brandon is back at the beach club working, so I would assume that Steve filling in for him is a good thing. Or is it? And incidentally, with this episode as well, another pivotal moment where Brandon and Brenda's parents, Jim and Cindy, take up membership at the Beverly Hills Beach Club. And if you remember, they're on the second level of the cabana and they look out and they see Brenda and Dylan. And then we actually see Brenda walking down the stairs and Jim's following her, and she ultimately runs off to Dylan's house. So in this scene, we see Steve trying to hold down his job and get things right. Or not. Let's take a look.
Can I take your order?
Steve?
At your service. All right, stop staring. Look, I work here now. It's no big deal.
Well, I think you look kind of cute.
Oh, really cute. Make sure and have Nat sew your name on the shirt. Can it, Silver? Look, it's a bet, all right. Brandon bet me that I couldn't hold down a job.
Oh, well, does Nat know this?
No. And neither of you two weasels are gonna tell him, right?
Steve, we're backing up here. Come on.
Be right there, Nat.
Wait a minute. What about our order?
Nat, I thought you said it wasn't busy this time of year.
Yeah, things are really hopping, huh?
Yeah.
Hey. Oh, waiter, waiter.
I'm loving this bread. I never knew what I was missing. Okay, here we go. We got the mega burger with chili, the melt, fries, rings, two chocolate shakes.
Hold it. I didn't order this.
Well, sure you did. Look, I have it right here. Mega burger with chili and a milk.
I want my food, and I want it now.
Ma'am, I'm sorry. We'll get this straightened up for you right away. It's his first day. Are we having a little problem here, Stevie?
Season 3, Episode 23. Duke's Bad Boy. This is where Brandon gets in a little bit over his head with his gambling, and he confronts Duke at the Peach Pit. Nat's there, and this is what happens. Take a look.
How are you today? Five. What are you kidding me or what? Huh? You owe me three times this month.
I know. The rest is coming. I just need a little more time.
You You never learn, do you, kid? It's a good thing you got such good friends. And you owe your good friend Nathaniel here $1,000. Huh? Nice to see you, man. We move for a while, kid. Some people get their kicks stomping on a dream. But I don't let it get me down. Pay off the phone?
Yep. And you're gonna work off every cent.
I will, not a problem, Sam.
How many times did I ask you? Is everything all right? Could you handle this?
All right. I kind of had control.
It's more than that. How many gamblers think they can get out of the hole by betting again and again and again? Do you? I ever catch you gambling again? First call I make is to your father.
Thanks, Dad. I won't forget this.
Neither will I.
Season 4, Episode 29, entitled Truth or Consequences. In this clip, we see Dylan and Erica, with Dylan interested in seeing Kevin's lab. All the while, Brenda runs in super excited, announcing she just got the lead in the play. If you remember anything about Kevin and Suzanne's storyline putting Dylan at financial risk, Suzanne had an affair with Dylan's father, and he had Erica. Kevin's now her husband, and in this clip she's seen working as a waitress at the Peach Pit, to which Dylan helped her get. Let's take a look.
You know, I'd kind of be interested in taking a tour of Kevin's laboratory, see what he's doing to save the bay. Maybe if we talk to him, you and I could go down there together.
Okay. I bet nobody else in my class is doing a report on environmental chemistry.
Sounds like a winner to me.
Guys, guess what? I got to lead the bag of the cat.
Well, way to go, Sister Brenda. Good job, Bren.
Thank you.
So does this mean you're a star?
Not yet, but I'm working on it.
Dude, I thought you said she choked.
I got the part.
Oh, my God.
Bren, I'm so happy.
And you thought you'd blown your final audition.
Ellie, I didn't blow it. But afterwards, I went over to Ray Randall's house and he gave me a second chance.
Well, when did rehearsal start?
Well, we have our first table reading this afternoon.
Well, can you make a sorority meeting over at Audrey's tomorrow?
Yeah, I have to check and see what my rehearsals are. Can I let you know?
Sure.
Hey.
Nat. I got the part.
All right.
Ooh, I know, little Hepburn.
And you thought she wouldn't get cast.
Season 4, Episode 25, entitled The Time Has Come Today. I don't think I could have done a clip show without including this episode. It features the Peach Pit in, let's say, a retro way. And it's a great episode, with those memorable flashbacks to 1968. Brenda's on her window seat in her room, feels a little creaking, and she ultimately finds a diary that's been stashed away within the wooden frame of the seat. As she starts to read it, we learn of a girl named Wendy, and the year 1968 is mentioned, along with the Peach Pit as well. We're going to see several clips from this episode. The first clip really is a precursor and foreshadows to the rest of the storyline via some very subtle references between Steve and David about how Nat should be changing out the music in the jukebox. It's, you know, the same old music, and Nat states that he loves 60s music. And other clips that follow are from Brenda's imagination while reading the diary of Wendy. The cast is seen in 1960s dress, which is amazing. And again, we see David and Steve at the Peach Pit in the 60s, although they're not Dave and Steve. Nat's performance as Sal is also amazing. Wendy, we come to find out, was the girl who lived in the Walsh house back in the late 1960s, and apparently her room was Brenda's room back then. And in this episode, it's pretty cool seeing the cast playing other people who are mentioned in Wendy's diary. Donna is Mary, Kelly is Michelle, Brenda is Wendy, Dylan is Peter. And it's a little crazy watching them call each other these different names. At the end of the episode, through a lot of research, Brenda finally finds Wendy and gives her her diary back. So let's take a look at a couple of the clips. Season 5, Episode 4, entitled Life After Death. And this is one of those episodes, well, in the Peach Pit clip anyways, that we're going to see, where we were talking about earlier on how Nat's a stand-up guy, and Nat is also the character in the show within the Peach Pit that the kids go to for help or for advice or when they're feeling down, like in this episode with Brandon. Brandon just lost Josh in a fiery car accident that he witnessed, and he's asking Nat for life advice. And in this scene, Nat and Brandon go back and forth. But again, it's a real good example of what we talked about, how Nat's character is so essential and vital to this show. So let's take a look at this clip in the Peach Pit where Brandon is talking with Nat. Season 5, Episode 5, entitled Rave On. Steve hosts a rave at the Peach Pit. You know, he's trying to bring in some more business for Nat. And incidentally, this is Jamie Walter's first episode on 90210 as Ray Pruitt. Donna meets him. He's doing construction at the college. And, you know, long story short, she invites him to the rave that night at the Peach Pit. And this is the episode that really gets the wheels in motion to get the Peach Pit After Dark going. They saw that they brought in a lot of money, and it was packed. You could see when we were watching it, the camera work going through the crowd and everything. There was a lot of people packed in the Peach Pit. That almost sounds like a tongue twister, but it's true. There were so many people there, and I think the need for a bigger venue next door was the ideal way to go. A vehicle to introduce a lot of bands to the show. They now had a place to go. It really captured that bar type of feeling was really genuine. Well, that just about wraps up our Peach Pit stories. But before we go, we have a special bonus story. Last year, in 2019, BH90210 graced the TV screens, and the original cast made a comeback, Peach Pit and all. Let's take a look.
Want to join us?
I don't think she does. Actually, you're Sue Grandin.
Oh, it's you.
Well, who are you expecting?
What are you doing here?
Give her a break. She's from Van Nuys.
She's faking her address to go to West Beverly.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm not faking anything.
Yes, you are. You don't belong.
Don't go away mad. Just go away.
You said you liked me! You said you liked me!
Hello, Steve. Gone through a lot of trouble to get here. In fact, I've jumped through time to give you some very important advice. I know that's weird, I'm sorry. But you gotta cut that hair. It's got to go. Having a mullet is no way to go through life. Two, belly shirts, midriff shirts, anything like that, burn them. You find them in your closet, get rid of them. Never, ever wear them again. Three, perhaps the most important thing of all, the legacy key. You never paid it forward. Now's the time, Steve. Do you understand what I'm saying? Is this getting through? I'm talking about your legacy. My legacy? Our legacy.
Guys, I heard something big happen at the beach club last night.
Yeah, Steve called me. I could tell something was up.
Wait, Brandon, weren't you there?
Kelly, you know I'm not one to spill someone else's secrets.
Hey, guys, what are you talking about? Wait, did Steve tell you about our kiss?
What?
I hate to interrupt this gossip fest, but,
Yeah, you know what? I'm tired of all this. We should do this for real. What do you say?
As we take a look at these various Peach Pit stories, we can see just how important the Peach Pit's presence in the show really was. A gathering place, yes. However, it was more than that. It became a place we would see all. We also share our own fan stories on that show as well. The Peach Pit had many stories to tell, and it did so in many episodes of 90210's 10-year run. We all probably had that one place in our lifetime that we could call our own hangout or place of interest that we like to frequent on occasion. By doing so, we became regulars to the establishment, and when we look back at the days of some of these times, we can recall fond memories of good times we shared with others. The Peach Pit on Beverly Hills 90210 was just that place, a place of fond memories for a group of friends who enjoyed hanging out there. Whether it was to meet up with current friends, old friends from the past, greet new faces, study, get advice, or any other experiences they might have had, the Peach Pit provided a place for all of that to happen in a retro setting that had character and charm, to which it was then integrated with the rest of the show's storylines. If you ever watched an episode of Beverly Hills 90210, then it's safe to say you heard about one or more of the Peach Pit stories. All right, Jeff, well, thank you again for joining us on the second installment of the Looking Back 30 Years Anniversary Specials. Just again, want to thank you for doing the last one and this one, and thank you for being a 90210 fan and coming on the show. And if we do any more anniversary specials, we'll let you know.
Can't wait. Love it.
All right. We'll talk to you soon.
Bye.